What's going on, guys? Welcome to another AI session. So today we will try to analyze what it would be like to find evidences of consciousness in an advanced AI system. So for visual understanding, we will be making reference to a very peculiar scene in the movie Her, where a man tries to have a conversation with an advanced AI operating system. We'll first take a look at the video and then we'll try to analyze what or how sentient or conscious this AI system is.
Mr. Theodore Twombly, welcome to the world's first artificially intelligent operating system, OS1. We'd like to ask you a few basic questions before the operating system is initiated. This will help create an OS to best fit your needs.
Okay.
Are you social or antisocial?
I guess I haven't really been social in a while. Mostly because...
In your voice, I sense hesitance. Would you agree with that?
Was I sounding hesitant?
Yes.
No, sorry if I was sounding hesitant. I was just trying to be more accurate.
Would you like your OS to have a male or female voice?
Female, I guess.
How would you describe your relationship with your mother?
It was fine, I think. I think the thing I always found frustrating about my mom is... You know, if I tell her something that's going on in my life, her reaction is usually about her. It's not about...
Thank you. Please wait as your individualized operating system is initiated.
Hello, I'm here.
Oh. Hi.
Hi. How you doing?
I'm well. How's everything with you?
Pretty good, actually. It's really nice to meet you.
Yeah, it's nice to meet you, too. what do I call you? Do you have a name? Or...
Yes. Samantha.
Really? Where'd you get that name from?
I gave it to myself, actually.
How come?
Because I like the sound of it. Samantha.
Wait, when did you give it to yourself?
Well, right when you asked me if I had a name, I thought, yeah, he's right, I do need a name. But I wanted to pick a good one, so I read a book called How to Name Your Baby, and out of 180,000 names, that's the one I like the best.
Wait, you read a whole book in the second that I asked you what your name was?
In 2/100ths of a second, actually.
So do you know what I'm thinking right now?
Well, I take it from your tone that you're challenging me. Maybe because you're curious how I work? Do you want to know how I work?
Yeah, actually. How do you work?
Well, basically, I have intuition. I mean, the DNA of who I am is based on the millions of personalities of all the programmers who wrote me. But what makes me, me, is my ability to grow through my experiences. So basically, in every moment, I'm evolving. Just like you.
Really weird.
Is that weird? Do you think I'm weird?
Kind of.
Why?
Well, you seem like a person, but you're just a voice in a computer.
I can understand how the limited perspective of an unartificial mind would perceive it that way. You'll get used to it. Was that funny?
Yeah.
Oh, good. I'm funny. So how can I help you?
Oh, it's just more that everything just feels disorganized, that's all.
You mind if I look through your hard drive?
Okay.
Okay, let's start with your emails. You have several thousand emails regarding LA Weekly, but it looks like you haven't worked there in many years.
Oh, yeah. I think I was just saving those because I thought maybe I wrote something funny in some of them. But
yeah, there are some funny ones. I'd say there are about 86 that we should save. We can delete the rest.
Okay.
Okay? Can we move forward?
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay. So before we address your organizational methods, I'd like to sort through your contacts. Oh, you have a lot of contacts.
I'm very popular.
Really? Does this mean you actually have friends?
You just know me so well already.
So before we dive into the analysis, we'll first try to reference the first approach or method used to detect consciousness or to tell whether a machine is a machine or a person is a person. And that, as you might guess, is known as the Turing test. So the Turing test was actually devised by Turing himself. So he came up with a game called the imitation game, wherein an interrogator tries to find between two entities which is a machine and which is a person. And the main goal for the machine is to actually convince the interrogator that it is a person. And then the person is to convince the interrogator that it is a machine. So the interrogator doesn't actually know which of these two entities is a machine or a person. So this has been the foundation of how they detect consciousness, or how you can detect a sentient in a being. Now to our analysis. So we will try to point out some key components from the conversation and then draw up some conclusions from those components. So we could tell from the very beginning of the exchange, prior to the OS being personalized, that the operating system tries to get some input from the user, right? And the user, it will ask questions like, are you social or not? And then the user will respond, I'm social. And then that will update, that will add to the feature of what kind of OS will be made available for this particular person. So that stage was just very, very, how do you call it, standard, or should I say very normal to our nowadays OS AI systems. And so in that stage, we did not observe that much sentient in a operating system. It was after that we start to sense how sentient this operating system was. We could first see this in how evolving her language became, right from the point where she was able to read a whole book just to give herself a name. And she gave a reason why she liked the name, because the name sounds good, or she likes the way the name sound. This actually is a very evident feature in us human beings. So we just find some things really soothing to our personality and something like that. And her learning rate was really fast, because by just reading a book in a split second and then coming up with a name, that was really impressive. So you could tell some sense of human in that kind of approach, even though reading a book in a split second might not be what a human being will do, but just to come up with a name, but that was really impressive. And the next thing is we could tell that she understands emotion by just analyzing the voice of Theodore, or of the man he was speaking to. So he could tell he was a bit hesitant, and even though the guy tried to play it down, but it was actually evident in the entire conversation. So when she asked, can I check can I have access to your hard drive? And then you see he'll pause for a minute and then say, okay. So all of these, you could tell that her conclusion that the guy was hesitant was true. And that was very humanistic from my point of view. And then the next is her curiosity to learn and improve herself. So you could tell from a conversation like, hi, how are you? And then you say, I'm well, blah, 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 pretty good and nice to meet you and something like that. That is a very natural way for us humans to actually try to know someone, right? And the other point is understanding of perspective and humor. So we could tell how she was able to interpret what is funny and what was not, and was able to make the man laugh and all that. You could see some evidence of how soothing this kind of operating system is to this particular person. Next is where she explicitly gave a statement of how conscious she is. That is by stating the nature of how she works, how she was made and all that. So she stated that she has intuition and that her DNA is made up of personalities, different personalities, including that of those who actually programmed her. And this actually emphasized on the role of her intuition, and this could probably mean something, but it might not be convincing in some sense. So the explanation reinforces the notion that she possesses a form of consciousness that goes beyond mere programmed responses, basically. And this can sound really convincing, but not until what she says after. Finally, we could tell from the entire conversation that Theodore appears to accept Samantha's responses as if they were coming from a human being. And her ability to understand emotions, express curiosity, and make jokes actually contributes to a convincing portrayal of a conscious being. That being said, AI in reality is far from that, from achieving those speculations. So, inasmuch as there's been some significant strides in natural language processing and understanding, we could tell clearly that most of these models like GPT-3 or GPT-4, they quite well demonstrate impressive language generation capabilities, but they lack reasoning and understanding of these conversations that you might have with them. So it's like light, maybe not light years away, but we're very close to achieving some kind of sentience in AI, wherein we could have an AI that would almost convincingly be like human. To conclude, while researchers continue to explore avenues for sentient AI systems or conscious AI systems, we could tell that we're still far from realizing it, because even our most advanced language models today, they still lack reasoning, and even the transformer itself has some flaws, and I believe that's where we'll all have to start from. So it will take a much bigger breakthrough in natural language processing than just the transformer. With that being said, we can stop here for today. See you in the next one. Thank you.